Listen to our joys and struggles, our laughter and tears. You gave them legs to run to us when we fall, and arms to pick us up again, to hold us as we cry, or cradle us while we sleep. You gave them hands to wipe away the tears, to brush the hair from our eyes and dirt from our faces, to hold when we're scared, or when we want to dance, or when we just need a little help. You gave them mouths to kiss away the pain, and voices to encourage and comfort, to pray with us and for us. You gave them minds full of ideas and wisdom, and hearts full of love. God, on this Mother's Day, bless our mothers. Give them your strength, peace, and love, so they may continue to give it away to all those around them. Amen.
Amen. Go to Psalm 22, if you will. Psalm 22 today. Psalm 22. I want you to think for just a second. There's a pulse in that particular film that almost sounded like a heartbeat. You know, for little children, for little babies, it's really quick. Have you ever heard the heartbeat of a child? It's just like boom, 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 boom. I mean, it's just unbelievable. And in the womb, a child beats. His heart beats. He has a pulse. As a matter of fact, he has a brain function. Get this. At 7 weeks, the very first impulses of his brain start. 7 weeks from the time that that child is conceived. Miss, where's Sarah, my daughter-in-law? Is she in the nursery or something? Okay, right here. Sarah, how far along do you think you are? 6 weeks. 6 weeks. You know, you got 1 week and your kid starts to think. That's unreal. That's unreal. And I'm going to tell you some real specifics about that in just a minute. But in Psalm 22 and verse 9, this is what Jesus Christ is described as saying about himself through David. Get this. This is Jesus Christ talking about himself through David, 1,200 years before his physical body came to earth. A lot of people believe God created Jesus. How many of you know that's bunk? That's nonsense. Jesus always was. He says he's Alpha and Omega. He's from the very beginning. He's created at the very beginning. Get this, my friends. Jesus Christ, 1,200 years before he was born, wrote this. But thou art he that took me out of the womb, speaking to his father. Thou didst make me hope when I was upon my mother's breasts. I was cast upon thee from the womb. Thou art my God from my mother's belly. Come on down, ushers, we take up our morning offering. I think for just a moment about what those words say and the impact it ought to have on our hearts. Do we realize that from conception, God is already forming a relationship with every child? Do you get that? From conception, God is already forming a relationship with every child. And when, for some reason, a child dies, that relationship is cut. It may be that people don't understand the reasons behind what God is doing with reference to creating beings in women. It doesn't matter whether we understand it or not. Most certainly, we're going to see some things today that I think will blow our minds with reference to little babies. Father, help us to remember that moms are special. That the reason that they're mothers is because they have children, whether that be through adoption or whether that be through the means of actually taking them from their body and having them born from them. I thank you, Lord, for the joy and the blessing of motherhood. I glorify you for this day. I praise you, Lord. We know that many of our families are away. Many are visiting moms all over the place. You know, many of them will be back tonight. We know that. But, oh God, I'm asking that you'll bless them wherever they are, that they'll have an effect, oh Lord, that the seed that's spread all over Sussex County and maybe even down in Virginia, up in Pennsylvania, that they would be testimonies, that they'd be light, that they, Father God, would spread your truth everywhere and that you'd be glorified as a result. And we'll thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on up here. Anybody that knows Rock of Ages, Clef for Me, why don't you come up here and sing with me as a choir? You say, I'm not part of the choir. It doesn't matter. Come on up here. Let's just fill up the front here. Stand, dear ones that want to come. Stand and come on up here. 342, Rock of Ages, Clef for Me, let me hide myself in thee. You know something, my friends? There are little rocks all outside of our building here. How many of you have noticed that? You've seen those little red rocks all the outside of the building over here? You know, every one of those is like what Jesus described Peter as being. And all of us are precious stones, all right? But we're little guys. You know who the big guy is? Jesus Christ. He's the Rock of Ages. He's the one that's broken up for me. He was the one that was broken for my sin. And he's cleft there in the rock for me. Let me hide myself in thee. Why don't you sing with us, dear friends, as we sing to you? You sing to us, we'll sing antiphonally. One.
Come on, Pastor, come on up here with me. You can stand beside me and you can sing this with me. I am a woman. I'm just kidding.
Do we have to do this with a higher voice every day?
Sarah, come sing with us. Come on. Barb, come sing with us. The four of us. Come here, Barb. Come here, Sarah. Come on. Sarah, come on. Come here. She's the woman. I'm a dude, man. She's the woman. Come on.
We're going to sing men.
We're putting the women in the middle. Put the women. Go in the middle. Go
on,
in the
Sarah,
middle.
Back.
Hey. You take your lapel, I'll take mine. We'll let them sing it, okay? I ain't no trans, I'll tell you that. All right, here we
we'll
go.
We'll sing men.
Follow me. breaker to be.
I was watching Keith Hale sing that so sweetly. I'm so glad he's coming to sing a special now. One of our women men is coming to sing now.
I planted a rose bush and I tended it with care. Its buds began to blossom, their sweet fragrance filled the air. But when winter came, it withered, the petals drooped and fell to the ground. My heart sank as it faded, but I've forgotten who had made it. And he said, roses will bloom again, just wait and see. Don't mourn what might have been, only God knows how and when, but roses will bloom. Was his only sweetheart, a loving wife of 40 years. They cherished every day they had, held the memories so dear. He never dreamed he'd bury her, go home to live alone. But when he laid his rose to rest, heaven and tried his best to believe that roses will bloom again. Just wait and see. Don't mourn what might have been. Only God knows how and when, but roses will bloom again. Precious rose of Sharon, broken and bruised, oh what a shame. He stained the cross at Calvary so that men might be saved. Satan cheered as he died, while Mary and the others cried. Then God raised him up from death's seat, kept a promise only he could keep. Roses will bloom again, just wait and see.
Hey.
Don't mourn what might have been, only God knows how and when, but roses will bloom.
The Rose of Sharon, who is that? Jesus Christ. What happened to Jesus? He was crushed. Yeah, he was crushed. He was buried, and 3 days later he rose again. That's what it says. Fantastic. Hey, let me give you a few things to think about. First and foremost, these are really neat. I mean, these totes that they put, it says the fruit of righteousness is a tree of life. Proverbs 11:30. Look at this. You got all these kinds of verses. Jesus loves the little children, all the children of the world. Beautiful little bags. And there are a lot to choose from. How many different kinds are there, Earl? Must be 20 different kinds that you can choose from, ladies. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. That's a fantastic, just a fantastic set of these totes that you can take home and you can use your groceries for them, or you can put your husband's tools in them. That won't work, will it? No. They'll probably break to pieces if you... Go to Psalm 22 this morning. I'll give you a few things to think about. The glorious graduation Friday night. How many of you saw that? What an incredible thing. There were five graduates. My mother, why don't you stand, Mom? This is Dr. Pat Segrest right here. Dr. Pat Segrest. Unbelievably beautiful time. Very well done by the college. Last night also, for me, was an amazing time. I had time to be with my family. How many of you have been with your family in recent days? You know, sometimes work keeps us away, but you got to have an evening with your family. You know what I'm saying? Do that once in a while. And prayer night on Tuesday was phenomenal. Get with your family and bring them to prayer night. Bring some of your men guy people, you know, whether it's your dad or your children or whatever, to strong men's night on Thursdays. Come on Wednesday for the full family, full throttle family time. That's an hour of power on Wednesday night, 6 o'clock, the snacks and all the good stuff that goes along with it. Tomorrow, my friends, I'm going to be taking a break. But on Tuesday, we plan to go out on visitation at 4 o'clock. And I hope that you'll be there to enjoy. Mother's Day this morning is a beautiful time. And I want to just take a second and focus a little bit on some things. Breakfast was full again today. I really appreciate the great many people that came early today. I hope you'll pray for them. Continue to pray for our whole group of people, the whole individuals that are working and moving and having, you know, Stephen Carroll puts a lot of time into that in the mornings, and others who have done a great job. I'm just so grateful. And Sunday school has grown significantly since we started the Fishers of Men's campaign, and I think the Lord is really working in that particular area. I'll tell you tonight who won. This morning I did not get a chance to look at all, and so we'll see. What happens. Sign up for game night, if you will, all right? That's actually a game afternoon. Starts about 4 o'clock, and it's going to be a great deal of fun. I think this is, let's see, game night Shack. Yeah, there it is, right there. And this, already several have signed up. Why don't you take one of those, and we'll put the other one over here. There you go. And then there is evangelism training to sign up for. Hey, that Memorial Day picnic, I was told to make emphasis of this, so that we can be sure that we have some that are committed to bringing their barbecues, okay? Their barbecues. So is there someone that would say, I will put it in the back of my truck, and I'll bring a barbecue. Everybody's going to bring meat. We'll bring some for the church as well. You know, you're not incumbent on providing the meat, just the barbecue. Now you say, when is that? Okay, so it's Sunday. Memorial Day picnic is Sunday night, May the 29th, and we're going to start at 4:30. And if you want to be here at 4 o'clock, then we'll start fires and all that kind of thing. I'm hoping and praying it'll be a good night. I believe it probably will. If someone's saying, Pastor, I'll bring my barbecue. I'll commit to bring my barbecue that night. Let me see. I'm the only one. Okay. Well, I'll talk to you individually. Will you really? It's just a truck that you need. Okay. Is anybody else in that situation where you need a truck if you're going to bring yours? Okay. I'll tell you what. We could probably get it done with the one that I've got and the one that you've got. All right? Let's just do that. And we'll just make them hamburgers and hot dogs and stuff. I'd like to get some steaks and some chicken and stuff, but we'll have to have others commit to do it because we'll need several barbecues if we're going in that route. Well, that's the one I'm talking about that I have. So it's just because I can't bring one. We don't have one at home. So this is the one that we'd be using. Yeah, bring it. Will you? If you've got a smaller one, bring it. Yeah. Perfect. There you go. Bring it. Anybody else? Okay, so are you committed to that? I'll be committed to that. You guys committed to that? Anybody else? Anybody else? Would you? Uh-huh. Good. Thank you, Jay. That's awfully nice of you. Man, that's awfully nice of you. Now, Jay has done that before, and I know one day he's going to give $1 million to the building fund. So, yeah, we'll see what happens with that. But I'm so grateful to all of you for the things that you do. The sign-up for Memorial Day, get a hold of it, right? Oh, it's in my hand. I guess you ought to have that, right? VBS is coming up. When is that VBS involvement meeting? When are you guys doing that? Sarah? Do you have a date or? June the 11th. June the 11th. And we'll start announcing that a little bit early, the VBS meeting. Do we want our guests to know? Let me ask you guys this, and then I'll be done with announcements. First of all, mom gifts. And by the way, Barb, I love you, honey, so much. And I thank you for being my wife. I realize you're not my mother, but you certainly are amazing to many people in this church. And I just want to recognize you because you never get recognized. This woman is raising 9 children, okay? And she really is quite a mother. Quite a mother. Quite a mother. And my mom raised, you know, I guess collectively as far as nerve difficulty and hardship, she raised me. It's stunning. What disparaging remark was made? Listen, do you want our new guests and the ones that come in? We had quite a few in the morning. Some have gone from Sunday school. There were some that were here for Sunday school that went. But the unsaved, our new attenders, do you want them to know how to be saved? You do? You want them to know how to be baptized? You do? Do you want them to learn how to be discipled? Okay, so you've got to send them to my class. Now listen, it's not a joke. Listen to me, I'm serious. We've kind of gotten into this competition where we're shooting ourselves in the foot. They need to know salvation when they walk in the door. If people are going to be here early, they need to know salvation. Listen, I won't count them. I promise you. You can have them for your class, but I just need to get them in there to give them the full plan of salvation. How many of you were in that class and enjoyed the presentation this morning? Okay, very, very good. Because it gave the full plan of salvation. We'll be going through baptism, discipleship, giving, all the things that a new believer needs. But if you take them in here and teach them about Paul or whatever, then they leave without that basic knowledge that they need. Do you understand, Michael, what I'm saying? You can teach them all about being a couples in couples class, but it won't do anything. Do you understand? So I'm not joking. I'm not playing around. I really mean this. It's important for us as a church to, you know, to have fun, and then after that, to send them to my class so they can at least go through the basics. And then I'll give them back to you. I promise you, I'll give them back to you. How many? Stephen says, all right, you've had your piece. Stop bringing everybody to your class. All right, good. Hey, grab Psalm 22, won't you? Psalm 22. All right, the title to this message is a little bit different. This message completely is a little bit different. It may even be a little shorter. I'm not promising that, okay? Because if we really get on a roll, we'll be here a little bit. But here's the title. Listen close. What does it mean? Don't get me wrong. Don't start throwing rocks at me one way or the other. What does it mean to choose to be a mother? All right? What does it mean to choose to be a mother? Well, I realize that pro-life is something every human should be. I would hope we want to live. I would hope we want things to live, not just humans. I would hope that we love our planet, but it is a choice. You do know this, right? It's a choice to be a mother. And choices are a major part of society. I don't understand. You know, our society is so weird. 31 flavors of ice cream, really? Is that necessary? I mean, how many of you love peanut butter? Okay, how many of you love chocolate? How many of you know Pastor does too? All right. What's the best candy in the world? No Chaussiers. I'm telling you, you got to check out the Chaussiers from Aldi's. In any case, huh? Yeah. Cindy Mulder went down the other day. She said, I was going to get one, but I just want one. I don't want 50 in a bag, right? Listen, we all have buyer's remorse, Cindy. You know what I'm saying? We all have buyer's remorse. How many of you bought a car you wish you didn't buy? Okay. How many of you bought something that you wish you didn't buy? Oh, there's a whole lot more. Okay. We want to understand that. We understand how this works. But in our society, you know, in Uruguay, it's not like this. You don't bring anything back to the store. You decide in the store, I want this enough to live with it forever. Okay? I want this enough to live with it forever. So I'm making my choice. And here's the deal with this, my friends. Understand this. You make that choice when you come in contact with it. Okay, can you say that phrase with me? You make a choice when you come in contact with it. Are you seeing where I'm going with this? Our choices are made. And I believe First Baptist Church is pro-choice. We're pro-choice on a number of levels. We're pro-choice so that you will receive Christ as your Savior. We're pro-choice so that you decide to have Him come into you and blood, the blood of Christ cleanse you. We're pro-choice on every level. Pro-choice for ladies. Pro-choice for them to be able to make the decisions that they need to make. But my friends, I believe that that choice starts at a certain time. We've got to understand that our right to choose is very important. How many believe that? All right, our right to choose is very important. The right to choose to be a mother, however, takes place, listen to this, at the first glance. Do you understand what I'm saying? Your right to be a mother, your right to choose to be a mother, is at the first glance. It takes place at the grocery store. It takes place at church. It takes place outside a hotel room. That's your choice. That's the choice you get to make. Right there, I'm not going to do this. I am going to do this. It takes place when someone asks to meet alone with me. If I choose to meet someone alone, I'm making a choice then. Hey, more power to you. Knock yourself out. Make your choice. But once it's made, there are consequences to that choice. Do we get that? Do we understand that? Now listen, we're a society that doesn't believe in consequences anymore. If you decide to be a homosexual, I will tell you this, that the CDC has professed that 96% of homosexuals either get some kind of STD or AIDS. That's your choice. You get to do that. It's not a healthy choice, but it is your choice. And then you live with that consequence for the rest of your life. When a child is conceived, the choice is made to have that child. You will not be released from the consequences of that. Oh, I can release myself. Oh, well, I think maybe if you think through it, you'll understand that you're not. You see, it does not take place, your choice, at the hand of a medical professional. My right to choose starts with whether or not I will give my heart to Christ rather than to sin. If you give your heart to Christ, I say this all the love I can muster in my heart, but I must tell the truth. Don't you think I should tell the truth? I tell you this with all the love I can muster in my heart, but I got to tell you the truth. Jesus Christ will set things right. He'll show you how to love like you've never loved before. And man, once you've met Him and you've decided to have a marriage bond with a man, I'm going to tell you something, my friends. That right there is the greatest thing. But I tell you, you can have a 30 babies after that, for all you want. But they've got to be made to human form. They've got to be brought into full fruition. Let's look at three reasons to choose Christ, okay? Let's look at three reasons to choose Christ in a patient, formal commitment rather than unbridled passion. Unbridled passion is a bad choice. Unwise passion is a bad choice. Deciding to do things that are not patient, that are not long-suffering, that are not wise, oh, it's a bad choice. And ladies, I'm not saying you're the only one that makes it. Guys, please make the right choice, okay? Men, make the right choice. Now, I understand, and I'm not going to ignore this fact. Some women never get to choose because people will force themselves on them. We do realize that. And that is why it's important to make a great choice to just never be alone with men. And men, leave ladies alone, for goodness sake. Leave them alone. It's wicked and wrong and evil to get after them and dog them and try to have them in a way that is improper. It's just, men, please. Now, there'll be that, and I looked it up. It's 3.7%. That are raped unwillingly. 3.7%. I've been told that's different. But those are the facts. I'm being told by society it's like half the women. That's a lie. Most of this is by choice. Now listen close. I do realize that maybe that percentage is much bigger when you start to realize that women aren't always going to say, well, I was forced. So listen, dear ones, stay out of back rooms. Stay out of hotel rooms. Stay out of these areas where a guy says, why don't you come back here? Why don't you do this? My friends, let's make some proper choices, all right? Patience, formal commitment. Let's be decent. You know, years ago, much less of that kind of thing happened. Why was that, Oscar? Why was it way back in those days? Why was it in the time, you know, I know, you know, for example, that Stephen lived in the time of Christ, right? Isn't that right, Stephen? Way back. Why was it that in the olden days there was a little bit more care? Because, listen, as time progresses, we're becoming more and more vile of a society. Look up here and listen to this. Do you know the Bible tells us that in the last days, love will wax worse and worse? Why? You say, well, society's always talking about love. Yeah, but it's not real love. You know that. Lust is not love. Passion is not love. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love takes time. Love thinks through things. Love is wise. Love is conditioned on this. 1 Corinthians 13. Real love, in its definition, is not impetuous. Psalm 22 in verses 9 and 10 gives us some understandings. Look at verse 9. Read this with me. Here are three reasons to choose Christ in a patient, formal love relationship with Him so that you can know then how to love a man, how to love a woman properly. David's psalm about Christ Jesus more than 1,000 years before He was even born says this. Read it with me. Won't you just the first verse? You ready? Here we go. But Thou art He that took me out of the womb. Thou didst make me hope when I was upon my mother's breasts. I was cast upon thee from the womb. Thou art my God from my mother's belly. There are three things that you'll see here, okay? Let me just back up and give you an understanding of something. Even when it's not your choice, don't choose to kill an unborn child. Just don't. You say, why, Pastor? It's still murder. It's still murder. Pastor, that's an awfully strong word. That's because, listen to this. Thou art He that took me out of the womb. No one should take a baby out of the womb. God alone takes a baby out of the womb. Now read that second phrase. Thou didst make me hope when I was upon my mother's breast. So, He takes me out. He puts me on my mother's breast. Now verse 10 says, I was cast upon thee from the womb. From the womb. Thou art my God. From the womb you cast me. Get this. Even before birth of a baby, before the birth of a baby, you'll see that there's some recognitions. Even before the birth of a baby, how many of you know that a baby can recognize sound? How many of you know that a baby searches for the sound of his mother? How many of you know, listen, I was reading Science American this week. How many of you know that title? Okay, all right, very good. Science American. Here, even before birth, babies recognize, they recognize sound and search for what is familiar to them. They did this test. Listen to this. This is crazy. They did a pacifier study. Now, do you know what a pacifier study is, Eric? Nope. I thought you still used one. You don't? Oh. you know, a pacifier study was done between Swedish babies, get this, Swedish babies and English babies. And what they did was they brought them together, and the child could tell the difference between what was English and what was Swedish because of brain activity and because of the way they sucked their pacifier. They saw a difference in the excitement levels and the understanding and recognition of what language it was and exactly who their mother was. And even though they can't hardly see, spatial ability. Now, listen close. I'm not speaking in Georgia, okay? Georgian talk, all right? I asked Sarah this week. She didn't know why. But I asked her, how do you say special in Georgian talk, all right? You know how you do it? You do it this way. You say, special. That's how you do it. Special. So I'm not talking about special. I'm saying it this way. Listen close. I'm talking about spatial. Spatial recognition, S-P-A-T-I-A-L, okay? Spatial recognition, spatial ability. Even though they can't hardly see, they know what's around them. Get this. This is incredible. The science proves that when a child is taken out of the womb and put on their mother's breast, get this, that he patterns with his hand. He patterns the mother's chest, and he knows his mother's chest. He will know his mother's chest from other mothers. You can put that child on another mother's chest, and it will not have anything to do with it. That child, he'll love, but he'll know, this is not my mother. The projection is so strong that he can spatially recognize without ever seeing with his eyes exactly what his mother's breast is. Listen to this. God says in Psalm 22, thou art he that took me out of the womb. Thou art he that caused the projection. Thou art he that gave me understanding of who I was and where I was. Thou art he that made all those determinations. Understand the second thing I want you to get, not just that God took me out of my mother's womb, but that God gave us hope when we were on our mother's breast. He gave us hope when we were on our mother's breast. Okay, open up your eyes and look up here and look up at the second half of that verse. Okay, you ready? Here we go. Thou didst make me hope when I was upon my mother's breast. Can I tell you this, my friends? Jesus Christ is the hope of the world. There isn't a single person in here that doesn't need him. Jesus Christ is the only way to heaven. He has made it clear that he wants to be your Savior. And he causes, even before you are ever in society, he causes us to hope while we're on our mother's breasts. In the second week, get this, in the second week after conception, a baby has a heart. How many of you know that? 2 weeks, they have a heart. You say, wait a minute, I've heard that the heartbeat comes much later. I didn't say heartbeat. I said heart. On the molecular level, you can actually see it at 2 weeks. Now get this. At 5 weeks, the first synapsis begins forming in the unborn child's brain. He starts, get this, he starts the first formations of thought. He cannot move his body still. until the seventh week. But in the seventh week, the neural tube closes, the brain separates into three parts, and the baby interacts with itself. And it becomes conscious of the things that it's doing in its own way to move. In the 12th week, that child is having thoughts, and he's already reasoning about the things that are around him. So can I tell you this? After the 12th week, when saline solution enters into a woman's uterus and she is destroying her child, he's feeling it all and reasoning as to why. See, this is what the Bible says. No, this is what science has taught us. And that is why our court system has gotten to a point where they're thinking, wow, what the Christians have been saying for years is true. These children are human. What the Christians have been saying for years is true. And that's why the courts are responding. And that's why people who are intelligently looking through this scientifically are understanding for the first time in their lives, this is real. This is real. That child is reasoning at 12 weeks. That child is feeling it at 12 weeks. Number three, God made me to depend on Him in my development. Look at this in verse 10. Look, I was cast upon thee from the womb. I was cast upon thee. Thou art my God from my mother's belly. So God made me to depend on Him in my development. Human beings are some of the most helpless in the world, according to science, when they're babies. All right? How many of you have seen the birth of a horse or something like that? Let me see. Okay, so how many of you have seen like a deer or any one of these creatures? Some of them four-legged. I've got goats, all right? So we watched the birth of goats, several times this year. And when they're born, I mean, now, Dad, how long does it take? How long does it take? The hours for the birth. But when they come out, how long did it take for them to start to stand? Minutes. I mean, and I didn't know that, actually, before we started all this. But the brain cognition of those creatures is so strong, they immediately start to stand. They start to respond to their mother. They start to sniff around. They start to try to find that milk. I mean, within that same hour, it's amazing how they're just bumping around and looking at things. And I'm thinking, in an hour. But humans are not like that. Humans are not like that. Our brains are built differently. Their brains are highly dependent. So a study was done on infants in the same magazine that suffered from the institutional living or from inadequate mothering. And it was quite evident that a child knows when it's not loved. Some of these things are just a miracle to think about. But in this study, they learned helplessness. Learned it. They learned from not being loved by a mother. They learned from not being held. They learned from not having the interaction with her, from not breastfeeding and all of that. They learned who loves them and how they are loved. You say, now, Pastor, what if a child can't breastfeed? They know. They know there's something about humans that the intuition is, it's crazy. Do you realize human beings are made in the image of God? Do you realize we have a soul, a spirit, and a body? Do you realize that our way of being is different, very different from any animal? We're not animals. You do get that. We're not animals. So the institutional liver, the inadequate mothering would prove, again, in this study, that they learned helplessness. In other words, babies know when mom doesn't want them. Can I tell you this? They don't have to be born to know that. I'm not talking about some pie-in-the-sky nonsense that has no scientific foundation. I'm talking about what has been discovered. You know what? There isn't a person in this room God doesn't want. You might say in your heart, you know, Pastor, I had an abortion. I had an abortion. Does God hate me? God loves you. God loves you. He doesn't care what you've done. He cares about what you can be. He's not interested in the past. He's interested in your future. He's desiring for you to be brought into Himself. And the amazing thing about our Lord and King and Savior is that He bled His blood for you, already knowing 5 million eons before He put the first star in the sky that you were going to have an abortion. He knew it 5 million eons before He even put the first star in the sky. He knew you were going to abort that child. He knew about your life. He knew everything that would take place. He didn't make it happen. Don't get to that. Don't start thinking that. That's false theology, this idea of Him making it. No, no, no. Your choice is your choice is your choice. But He knew what your choices would be. And you know what Romans 5 and verse 8 says? Hey, grab your Bible and go there and read it with me. Romans chapter 5 and verse 8 tells me something very special. Read it with me. You ready? But God commendeth His love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Jesus Christ loved you enough to put Himself on an old rugged cross. For 3 days He suffered, and on that last day for hours, He up and down on His cross moved against that harsh wood and broke Himself for you. I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see His wounds, His hands, His feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears. They laid Him down in Joseph's tomb, the entrance sealed by heavy stone, Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the name of the Lord my God. Oh, praise His name forevermore. For endless days I will sing His praise. Oh Lord, our God. Can I tell you something? That Lord, that glorified one that created every star and every planet and everything in this universe loves you. He loves you. He loves you. He loves you. It doesn't matter to Him what's happened. It doesn't concern Him at all what things have done. He knew the earth would be wicked. He knew it would go wrong. And He looks to you and He says, come to Me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I will take your sin. I'll take you. Take My yoke upon you and learn of Me. Now here's our God in John 3:16, so simple and beautiful and fresh. For God so loved the world. Why don't you stand with me, my friends? For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. You're standing here today. And you're saying, oh my God, is there anything that I can do to be saved? No, not a single thing. For everything that needs to be done has been done. And your God, who is Jesus, died on the cross for your sin so that you'd come to Him, so that you would receive Him, so that you would be saved from the fires of hell. Anybody here not guilty of the vile sins of the past? We're all guilty, are we not? I tell you something, it doesn't matter what's gone on in the past. Your God wants to save you now. Because Ephesians 2, 8, and 9 still says, for by grace are you saved through faith, and that is not of yourself. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Would you come, get down on your knees, and pray. Pray for salvation. Pray for the lost. Pray for our area. Pray right now that our nation is in turmoil, needing to understand the truth about real pro-choice. Real pro-choice. Would you come and pray for a nation lost? Pray for a nation broken. Pray for a nation that's needing new healing. Pray for people who need Christ. Pray for your daughter. Pray for your son. Pray for those that have made horrible mistakes. Those that have aborted children. Those who have had illicit relationships. Those that still are steeped in lies. Those who are still steeped in sin. Oh, my friends, I'm telling you, there isn't a single one of us better than any of them. The Word tells us in Romans chapter 2 and verse 1, thou art inexcusable, O man, thou that judgest, for wherein thou judgest another, thou condemnest thyself, for you do the same things. You do the same things. We're all sinners. We're all needing Him. We can't raise ourselves up in some way and say we're better. We just need by God's grace to make us what we can't be. Is there someone that would say, Pastor, I need to pray for my community? Or you may come and say, Pastor, I want to grab your hand and be saved. I've never been saved. I need to get saved. I need the blood of Christ to cleanse me. Come now if that's you. I'm not talking about religion and going to church and getting all spiritual. I'm talking about giving your heart to Him, actually doing that. There's someone who say, Pastor, I need to do that. And then community brother, Christian friend, you who are part of the First Baptist Church community, will you come and let's pray together? Won't we pray for our community? Pray for Sussex County. Pray for what's going on down the center of town. All over the country today, on Mother's Day, there are demonstrations being done against this new law that they're trying to implement through the Supreme Court. I wouldn't say it's a law so much as a decision, but just pray that God will give us wisdom as a nation to obey Him. To honor Him. Would you come and join me in prayer on that issue? Will you come right now? Come on down, won't you? And let's pray together. In a moment, I'll pray with you, okay? If you'll come with me, okay? Let's pray. Give you another minute to come. If you need baptism, come on down. You say, I've never been baptized. Well, come on down. If you need to be a member of this church, and you know, I don't have a membership anywhere, man, and you just say, I got to do that. I got to be a member of First Baptist. Would you come right now? Come on down right now. I'd be glad to talk to you about that. Anybody else? All right. Quite a few are down here on their knees, praying for the nation, praying for Sussex County. Would you come and just grab my hand, dear ones, and we'll make sort of a circle up here in the front. Come if you will, and we'll pray together about this issue, about our nation, about the things that are going on right now. And we'll just ask that the Lord will give us wisdom as we do, okay? If you want to just go against the walls all around, holding hands with individuals as a church, let's do this together. And we'll ask that the Lord will give us wisdom and help. Yeah, just right over there. Good, good. Thank you, dear ones. Thank you so much. It's awfully sweet of you. Yes. Awfully sweet. Very sensitive. Very sensitive. Let's pray for our nation together. I'll wait for you. I know some are still trying to make it around to where you can get a hold of a hand. You go right ahead and do that. Thank you so much. Appreciate that so much. Thank you. Thank you. Father, your people are gathered in this place brokenhearted. We're brokenhearted because there's a great many in the nation here that misunderstand Christians. They think we're against their choices. Lord, it's not true. It's a lie from the devil. He's trying to make people think we're against their choices. We're not against their choices. Oh God, we just believe that murder is murder. And we do believe that they can choose long before to live righteously in Jesus Christ. They can choose to receive the Christ of heaven. They can choose many different things in life that will elongate their life, that will give them heaven, that will help them. Oh God, we ask for choice. We ask you, dear Lord God, as you've given choice to humanity, that people will make the right choice, that they will choose Jesus Christ of Nazareth, that they will choose to live a pure lifestyle, that they will choose not to get into situations that would prejudice them. We choose, dear Lord, men would choose to leave people alone, that men would leave ladies alone, that men would choose to be gentlemen rather than to be a pornographic in their thinking, that they would choose to come to Christ and be cleansed from all of that, that they would choose not to pressure women, that they would choose to be pure and righteous. Oh God, we pray for Sussex County, especially right now. Our hearts are breaking for the turmoil. Our hearts are breaking for the pro-choice crowd. We want them to come to Jesus and to choose wisely, to have the real choice of Jesus Christ. Lord, may it be so, and may we love them, and may they understand that no one at church hates anyone, no matter what their thoughts are, regardless of what direction they're headed, even if they're confused in their gender. We want to help them to know Jesus Christ and to come away from sin, to put that sin away. Lord, every kind of sin, every kind of wickedness exists, even in me, Lord. What's the difference between one sin and another? But, oh, precious King, we ask you now to work in hearts and bring right choices to Sussex County and beyond. In Jesus' name, amen. I love you. Have a great day. You are dismissed.